Great. Good afternoon and welcome. My name is Reggie Jackson and I teach pre-modern Japanese literature and performance in the Department of Asian Languages and Cultures. And it's my pleasure to welcome you all here this afternoon for our CGS Noon Lecture. First of all, before I introduce our speaker for today, I just want to mention that next Thursday on October 24th, Yukio Maeda, Professor of Political Science at the University of Tokyo, will be speaking on, quote, the Prime Minister and Public Opinion on Japan. So also please check out the table in the back here, the CGS website and Facebook for more information on future CGS events. If you haven't, also please feel free to sign up for our event email list. So without further ado then, I'd like to introduce our speaker, Professor Ian Baruma, who is the Paul Williams Professor of Human Rights, Democracy, and Journalism at Bard College, New York. And today he'll be speaking, the title of his lecture is Reeking of Mud, Japanese Counterculture in the 1960s and 1970s. Professor Baruma studied Chinese at Leiden University, and cinema at Nihon University College of Arts in Tokyo. He lived in Japan from 1974 to 1980, and he's worked in Tokyo as a photographer, a filmmaker, and a journalist. He has worked as a writer and editor in Hong Kong, London, and New York, and contributed to many papers and magazines, including the New York Times, the New York Review of Books, and the New Yorker. His latest book is a memoir entitled A Tokyo Romance, and he's currently writing a book about the rise and fall of the Anglo-American order. Please join me in welcoming Professor Ian Baruma.
Thank you very much. Good afternoon. Thank you very much for inviting me. You just heard, I first arrived in Japan in 1974, and the thing that you heard from a lot of old hands in 1974 was, oh, you should have been here 10 years ago, which is, of course, what you very often hear. It was always a little bit better before. But the 60s in Japan were sort of already legendary by the early 70s. Japan, what people forget is that when they talk about the 60s, they think of Europe and the United States and the Beatles and the Rolling Stones and all that. But, of course, the 60s happened in many parts of the world, including Japan, where it was actually quite dramatic. And like many of these worldwide movements, each country and each culture has its own variation of what happens in a particular period, just as we see today that there are different kinds of right-wing populism in different countries, all affected and influenced by their own histories and cultures. So it was in Japan, and I hasten to say that, of course, this business of decades is always a tricky business, because when do they begin and when do they end? You could argue, and I like to think, that when I was in Japan in the early 70s, something of the 60s or the excitement of the 60s still lingered, even though some of the heroes of the counterculture in the 1960s had become very grand figures who were invited all over the world to do things and so on. Nonetheless, people said, you should have been here, oh, Tokyo in 1968, and the Fugetsudo, and the Futenzoku, the Japanese hippies who hung around in the west exit of Shinjuku Station, and the Angurao underground theater movement, and so on. And then, of course, the anti-Vietnam War demonstrations. And which really had petered out completely by the time I arrived there, along with the Vietnam War itself. But people forget how political Japanese students were in the 1960s, particularly when you talk to students today. It seems extraordinary that they were so political. The one thing that perhaps could serve as a sort of marker in time of the Japanese, or the end of the Japanese 60s, was the suicide, the seppuku of Mishima Yukio. And that was another thing that you heard from old hands, Americans as well as Japanese, sort of, I knew Mishima, or his biographer, Henry Scott Stokes, who later became the correspondent for the New York Times, who always insisted on calling him Yukio, and having known Mishima was a sort of a badge of honor. And he threw a big shadow over what had happened culturally in the 1960s, which lasted into the 70s. And there is perhaps a kind of seeming contradiction there in that Mishima Yukio was known for his far-right politics, for having formed a kind of militant band of supporters, mostly rather good-looking young men from fine universities, and who were trained to be a kind of right-wing militia aiming to reinstate the emperor in his old pomp and so on, and inject a new sort of militant and military spirit into Japanese, what they saw as decadent Japanese culture. In other words, he was a sort of, politically, very much a man of the right, whereas the young in Japan, very much, of course, including those who demonstrated for various causes more and more violently, very much on the left. But this contradiction was a seeming contradiction because actually there was a lot of overlap. And you see it if you go to YouTube. There's a famous occasion where Mishima appeared at Tokyo University talking to rebellious university students, and where he, in a black t-shirt, he looks much cooler than most of the students did. And he actually said to the students, if only you would recognize the emperor in the way I do, I'd be with you. And where it overlapped is the very strong resistance to American influence, even though the protests and the protesters themselves were very much influenced by American culture. But there was this deep ambivalence about post-war American influence. The left and right both had problems with the security treaty with the United States. The anxiety about that, but especially the sort of capitalist-driven modernization that took off with in the 1960s with the sort of Japanese economic miracle, very much influenced by the United States, was both something that concerned the left and the right. And I'm going to be talking about culture more than economics or politics. In cultural terms, it explains why, for example, Yakuza movies were very popular amongst student radicals. And Yakuza movies are actually very conservative. And the conservative and the Yakuza themselves, like all gangsters, of course, were rather right-wing. But the Yakuza movie, especially Takakura Ken, who became a great hero of the student left, are really all about the good guys who are traditional, who are very Japanese, who fight with swords and so on, against the bad guys who fight with guns and wear Western pinstriped suits and are bankers and real estate people people a bit like Donald Trump, really. And so the West was associated with that kind of capitalist modernization, and the Yakuza heroes were a sort of last-ditch resistance against that kind of thing, which appealed to the left as well as to the right. And so it's not entirely for nothing that Mishima played this role. And if you look at, the different cultural expressions of this, Yoko Tadanori, who was one of the great poster designers and artists at the time, did posters of Takakura Ken movies and so on. So the overlap was there. Now, my first introduction to the sort of culture, the counterculture, if you like to call it that, in Japan was through the theater. And I was a student of Chinese at Leiden University in Holland at a time when you couldn't really go to China unless you were an official friend of the people. And it was like studying the other side of the moon, and it was not particularly, unless you were a romantic Maoist, which some of my fellow students were, it was not a particularly appealing place either. I was never terribly interested in Maoism, and I found it very puritanical and rather off-putting. And while I was studying that, I saw Japanese films in various places, in Paris and Amsterdam and London and so on, by Oshima and Kurosawa and Ozu and Mizoguchi and so on. But I also was introduced to modern Japanese theater. And there was a theater in Amsterdam, which was a kind of world center of underground theater groups. They came from all over, from the United States, from various parts of Europe, even Africa, but also Japan. And it's where I saw a play by the Tenjo Sajiki, led by Tereyama Shuji. who was a poet, a filmmaker, had his own theater group, a novelist, and a sort of charismatic guru-like figure that you had all over the world in theater at the time. And the performance was called The Opium War, and I'd never seen anything quite like it. And we were led by various people through various rooms, and there were sort of opium dens, and there were huge blow-up pictures of manga and ukiyo-e, and there were sort of naked people naked, there was sex, there was violence, and so on. And I'd never really seen anything like this in the theater in my life before. And I thought, well, if that's what Tokyo is like, I'm on the bus. And so it was really through Tereyama's theater that I got interested in modern Japan. And I was not one of those people who was attracted by Zen or temples or wearing kimonos or anything of that sort. It was the modern aspect of Japan that I found interesting. And Tereyama's theater was the introduction. And then later, I became involved with another theater group led by an equally charismatic but very different character called Karajuro, who was the leader of the Still Alive, unlike Tereyama, who died rather young, who had a group called the Red Tent Theater, or the Jokyo Gekijo. And they would perform in a red tent, which they took all over Japan. They would pitch the red tent, and their styles are very different. Tereyama's style was really based on the kind of freak shows and theater and circuses and so on that he saw as a young boy in Niigata, not Niigata, Aomori, the northeast of Japan. And he was like a lot of people all over the world in the theater. In theater groups then, he was very interested in trying to theatricalize daily life and try to bring theater into the streets and so on, whereas Kara had a very different concept. And Kara's theater was really very much based on his childhood experiences of growing up in a slum near Ueno in bombed out Tokyo after the war, which was a world of petty gangsters and prostitutes and drag queens and so on. And although he was a very bookish boy who was quite highly educated, but he grew up in this extraordinary sort of rather wild and poor post-war environment. And it was the basis of his theater, really, which he then would mix up with myths, both Greek myths and Shakespeare sometimes, Japanese myths, and so it was a kind of surreal mixture of his childhood world mixed with all kinds of other theatrical elements. All of this played out inside this red tent, so not really in the streets. It was confined to the theater. Then you had Suzuki Tadashi of the Waseda Shogekijo, who had a very different style, who mixed traditional 18th century kabuki texts with a sort of very physical modern form of theatrical expression, which was sort of half dance and half performance. And then there was the Buto world, which I also got involved in, and I wish I would have been able to speak to you 2 weeks from now, because one of the groups that I actually knew, I knew the leader, the Sankaijuku, were very much a part of the world in the 70s that I knew in Buto. But the leader was a man called Hijikata Tatsumi. And he, again, like Tereyama, was very much inspired by the rural north, northeast, where he grew up, but also by various Western influences, like the Marquis de Sade German expressionist dance and that sort of thing. But what he really did was, even though there were these Western influence, he tried to get back in the form of a new form of dance to something that was uniquely Japanese. He wanted to get away from this idea of mimicking Western styles. He wanted to invent or reinvent in some ways a Japanese style, again based on his childhood experiences. And this you could describe, or has often been described, as doroksai, hence the title of this talk, reeking of mud, going back into the mud, into the earth, into the local native soil. Dochakui was another adjective often used, sort of native, to get away from sort of Western influence to something that was more native. And again, there's of course an overlap here between people who have rather right-wing sentiments to do with blood and soil and so on, and left-wing sentiments which resisted Westernization, especially in its sort of modern capitalist form. And what was interesting about the culture of the 60s and 70s was how everything was sort of interconnected, and you had a whole world of photographers, filmmakers, theater groups, even academics, who all knew each other, and sort of some of them were fierce rivals. I mean, the Karas group, the Jokyo Gekijo, and Terayama's group, the Tenjo Sajiki, I think it was in 1969, had a notorious battle in Shinjuku where members of the two groups fought each other and were then arrested and went to the taken to the police station and so on. That was, so there was the rivalry, but they all kind of worked together. So you had the photographers like Moriyama, who's now very famous all over the world, but he worked with both Kara and Terayama. You had Hosoe Eiko, who did famous photographs of Hijikata dancing through rice fields in the northeast and also in Tokyo, who also did a famous book of photographs of Mishima in various Mishima-like poses, often with sort of arrows sticking in his chest and that kind of thing, being run over by a truck, I think was one of them. So all Mishima's fantasies, which ended up in his fantastically theatrical suicide, were already there in the photographs taken by Hosoe Eiko. And then there was Tomatsu Shome, who did photographs of often set around US bases. He was perhaps the most ambivalent about American influence. And in his photographs, if you see the photographs he took in Okinawa, in Yokosuka and other places where they had US bases, you see it's more subtle than calling him anti-American. He showed both the Japanese fascination with America, the sort of sexiness of American pop culture and so on, and the deep resentment of and the sense of oppression of which goes back to the occupation period, really, but of being subjected to such an overwhelming influence and having to fight for your own identity in the midst of all that. And you see that really in his photographs, but you also see it in the theater and in movies. Imamura Shohei's movies, again, fit very much in this. Often, although he was a highly educated man who grew up in Tokyo, but his films are often about sort of peasant communities in the northeast, again very much reeking of mud, very 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 dorokusai. And they all work together, as I said, and scholars did too. The translator of the Marquis de Sade, who was called Shibusawa Tatsuhiko. And he was a great friend of Hijikata's and also of Mishima's. And so when there were sort of parties, you'd often meet all these people, all of whom are really trying to do the same kind of thing. And what overlapped, what they were trying to do, was this idea of reinventing a modern Japanese culture, was to go back to the sense of Japaneseness. And the style that they all in some ways conformed to was very physical, often violent, and very often erotic. Those are three things that really can there are elements that you see in all the works, in the film, in the theater, in the photography, and so on. And that, together with this great ambivalence about Western influence. Violence in the theater was, as I said, with the fight between the actors of the Jokyo Gekijo and the Tenjo Sajiki was often real, but it was also often theatrical. Terayama liked to think of physical confrontation, sometimes with the audience. And again, he wasn't unique. This was something that you, in various ways, found in underground theater all over the world. But was very much part of his performance. Sometimes it could get out of hand. In Germany, by accident, I believe, although you never can never be sure, one of the actors of the Tenshu Sachi actually set fire to one of the people in the audience, which Terayama rather delighted in. I don't think the victim was so pleased, but Terayama liked it. There was also an incident in that very theater in Amsterdam where I saw it, because people were in the Opium Wars. One of the techniques of the play was that you were shut up as the audience in different kind of cages where different things went on, and then you were led from one cage to another. But while you were in a cage, you couldn't get out. And one man, a middle-aged man, had actually been in a Japanese POW camp during the war, and did not appreciate being shut up in a cage by Japanese actors and freaked out. And again, this caused a great ruckus, which pleased Terayama. Hijikata staged in the performance, the Buto performance that actually made him famous in Japan, called Kinshiki, which was based on a Mishima story, Forbidden Colors. There was the rape of a young boy reenacted on stage. I mean, all these things now seem so far away from the culture that we're living at the moment. I mean, this extreme pushing of the envelope of how far you can go in with sex and violence. Now you couldn't possibly get away with it. But in the 60s and 70s, not only in Japan, but especially in Japan, and I'll explain the reasons why I think this is in a minute, this was very much part of the story. And perhaps the seminal movie of the period, although it was made, I think, in 1970, somebody can correct me, but in 1974 or 5, was Oshima Nagisa's In the Realm of the Senses, the Ai no Korida. And for those who have seen it, two or three people, four people. What he did something that nobody had done before, and I don't think anybody has really done since. He deliberately wanted to make a hardcore pornographic movie that was also a work of art. And actually he succeeded. I think it's a masterpiece of a kind. And it's based on a famous story, real story, about Abe Sada in the 1920s, who was sort of a prostitute. And she had this intense love affair with the owner of an inn where they had, a lot of prostitution took place. And it was very passionate. And one of the original aspects of the film is that it actually, the passion of the woman is taken even more seriously or shown with even greater honesty and clarity than the man. And so passionate that they start playing games. And one of the games was strangling one another and to the point that they almost choked, which sort of heightened the excitement of the sexual act. Well, one day this went wrong, and she strangled the man, and he did die. She then cut off his penis and walked around Tokyo for several days with her lover's penis in her handbag until she was arrested and spent some years in jail, then opened a club in Asakusa somewhere, where she had a very loyal following. And according to the great Donald Ritchie, American film scholar who lived in Japan since the war, who was one of the habitués of this club, she would make a grand entrance every night, always at the same time. I think it was sort of 11 o'clock, and she would come down the stairs. And as she came down, this was part of the ritual, all the men in the club would cup their genitals. And so that was Abe Sada. In any case, the movie is a kind of masterpiece. And it was part of something wider, which was linked, and here the politics come in. It was linked to the failure of the political rebellions of the 1960s. The generation that demonstrated against the security treaty with the United States in 1960, the so-called AMPO movement, felt that they'd failed, because they failed to stop the security treaty, they failed to stop the Vietnam War, Student protest really did not make a dent into the domination of Japanese politics by the conservative Liberal Democratic Party. There was a sense really by 1969 with the Tokyo student demos that this was sort of the end, and people had no more confidence in revolution or political protest of any kind. And it really disintegrated into extreme violence. And what began as a mass protest in the various universities, especially Kyoto University, but also others, Waseda, ended in small, very, very far left groups linked to the Red Army faction, who would hijack planes and shoot people in Lod Airport in Israel and so on. But it ended in an explosion of violence in a place near Karuizawa, where I think 12 people were murdered, 12 of their own were purged and murdered, and all this took place on TV. They were finally arrested and went to prison for a long time. But the disappointment in political protest meant that a lot of people who'd been very much involved in radical left-wing politics, oddly or perhaps not so oddly, ended up in the porno world. And so you had former Red Army faction sympathizers and members like Adachi Masao. And again, you see how all these groups were linked. Adachi Masao made movies, very violent porno movies, starring Karajuro, who was the head of the Situation Theater, and who also wrote film scripts for Oshima Nagisa. And so what happened in some ways was a traditional Japanese phenomenon where political protest became impossible, or people gave up on it. And so subversiveness and protest and so on shifted its ground and became sort of part of the sort of porno world, which was, Oshima Nagisa has written about this very eloquently, where they felt that, well, if we can't find a way to gain more political freedom, if we can't break the one-party LDP state, at least we can sort of push for more personal freedom, and personal freedom very much in an erotic sense, and including in Aino Korida, The Realm of the Senses, in some ways you could see it as a very feminist film, because it's sort of a celebration of female sexuality. But that's really where a lot of the political energy then ended up, which is why you could have a hardcore porno movie being a masterpiece, as I think it is. But it goes back, as I say, to a traditional Japanese form in the Edo period, when political protest, when protesting or rebelling against the Tokugawa shoguns was pretty much impossible. The subversion really took place in the world of kabuki theater and so on, which was set in what were then red, there weren't any red lights as far as I know, but in sort of areas where the brothels and the theaters were in the same part of the cities. And kabuki was, now it's a sort of fossilized form of high Japanese culture, but it began very much as a popular, rebellious form of theater. And the original kabuki actors were, of course, not men at all, but women, okuni, who were in fact prostitutes. And the rebelliousness of Edo, of the Edo period, was not political, although there were a lot of protests and rebellions and so on in the countryside, which people tend to forget, which were usually put down very quickly. So Japanese political history does have a long history of rebellion, but a lot of the rebelliousness was artistic, was in woodblock prints, in theater, and so on. And in some ways, Aino Korida and what the people, various people in the theater and film and photography and other arts were doing in the 60s and early 70s was to go back to that original spirit of kabuki. Now, this explains partly why there was the eroticism, why the violence. I think one of the reasons for it, and again, violence has a long tradition in Japanese art. If you look at Yoshitoshi's woodblock prints and so on, I mean, they're shockingly violent often, and Kabuki was often shockingly violent in a very stylized manner. But I think in the case of the artists and writers and theater people in the 60s, it came out of their own experience. Almost all of them were born just before or during or immediately after the war. They all experienced the violence of Japanese society in the early post-war period. Kara, who grew up in bombed out Ueno. Terayama, who lost his father, who was killed somewhere in the Philippines, and grew up around a military base where his mother was worked in a bar as a mama-san. Hijikata, it was rumored, I don't know if it was actually true, but it was rumored that he was trained to be a kamikaze pilot and only survived because the war was over before it was his turn to take off in a suicide plane. So they all had an experience of extreme violence, and people, you could see it in the movies made in the early post-war period, but the violence was very real that they experienced. And I think a lot of the art in the 60s and 70s was a way for them to come to terms with this. There was also an element of nostalgia for the 1920s, the Taisho, so-called Taisho democracy. And one of the slogans of the Taisho democracy in the 19th centuries was Ero Gudo Nansensu. Ero for eroticism, Gudo for Gudotesque, and nonsense for absurdity. And you see it in the poster art and in a lot of the visual art, even the music, some of the music of the 1960s and early 70s, that there was a nostalgia for this period before Japan became so militarized. So I think that also somewhat explains it. But the war was still present when I first went to Japan in a way that is really no longer true. For example, if you walked through Tokyo or any other big city in the early 1970s, you would still see men without limbs in white kimonos at the entrances of subway stations, playing the accordion and sort of old wartime songs, hoping to collect a few coins in a hat. And these were the veterans that had come back and were almost instantly forgotten and ignored in Japan. I mean, there was never a real government effort to take care of these people. I mean, they'd sacrificed themselves and came back maimed. But they had to try and eke out a living by begging. And that was still visible in the 1970s. So the violence of World War II and its aftermath was very much there. And you see it in Butoh dance. A lot of Butoh dance, I mean, those of you who are going to see the Sankaijuku will notice this. A lot of the Butoh dance is really about corpses very slowly coming alive with sort of grimacing faces but it's a sort of dance of death. It's very macabre, and you could say that in a way, and you see it in Terayama and Kara's plays too. There's almost always a Japanese soldier, a wartime soldier, who pops up somewhere like a ghostly figure. And these ghosts from the past were still there in the 60s and 70s, very visible, very noticeable, very tangible, and in a way that is really no longer true. The other thing, which I think is perhaps, and I've touched on it already, but is perhaps the most important, is the revolt against westernized high culture. And this was not simply a revolt against the West, even though there was anti-Americanism in the radical student movement and amongst Japanese artists and so on. But it was really less about the West itself, or even America, than about the influence of the West on Japanese culture since the Meiji Restoration. And when the Meiji Restoration took place in the 1860s, the Japanese elite had drawn the conclusion from the weakness of China and the enormous strength in those days of Western imperialism, that for Japan to survive, Japan had to learn as much as they could from the West and become as much like the West as they could in order to build up enough strength to survive in the world dominated by Western imperialism. And Bunmei Kaika, which was the slogan of the Meiji Restoration, the civilization and enlightenment, was very much part of that. And this is when classical Japanese culture, kabuki, no, and so on, became the sort of high art and lost a lot of its original, I mean, there are still great kabuki actors, but it lost a lot of that original earthy, muddy, erotic, violent spirit. And at the same time, Japanese theater wanted to become a form of sort of Western high art by playing Ibsen and Chekhov, and Japanese actors would often put on sort of long wax noses and wear blonde wigs, and they aspired to this sort of idea of high art that would be respectable and make Japan look respectable in the eyes of the West, and of course in the eyes of the Japanese elite itself. And so Japanese modern theater, Shingeki and Shinpai and so on, really was a Japanese version of Western theatrical high culture. And the Mishima described this in an essay he wrote, and he said, after the Meiji Restoration, the Japanese became like an anxious housewife who's expecting guests and wants to clean up the house as much as she possibly can and brush away every speck of dust so that the guests would not be shocked and would find the house that they were guests of fully respectable. In other words, you know, naked bathing in onsen was no longer allowed. Kabuki had to lose its original spirit, etc., etc., etc. And you could say that the generation of Karai and Oshima and Terayama and all these people really reacted against that spirit. And so the whole idea of Doroksai and Dochakui and so on was to strip that veneer of Western high culture from their modern culture to get back at something more basic and something more earthy. And that meant getting back to the body, which of course implies eroticism as well. And you see it in artistic movements, in the Gutaiha, for example, which is all about artists sort of confronting raw materials like mud and so on with their physically, with their bodies. And hence also the violence. And it's as though if you can get back to the body, back to the most basic element of human life, you get back to some essential Japanese artistic core that has freed itself from all those layers of civilization and enlightenment. And so it was an attempt to get to a certain kind of authenticity, which of course created a lot of very interesting stuff. It also left many people feeling ambivalent about it. I mean, by people I mean Japanese. And it led to a reaction. If you look at the generation that followed this generation, the 60s and 70s, you see a very different world developing, something more refined, more sophisticated, more ironic, more detached, more individualistic in a way. You could say in some ways that in Japanese you have an expression for very close-knit, tight human relationships full of, like sticky rice, full of sort of obligations and so on, which they often use the word wet, the English word wet for that, whereas more detached, individualistic attitudes are dry. You could say that the world of Kara and Hijikata and Oshima and so on was wet, whereas the world of, let's say, Murakami Haruki, the novelist, is very dry. And it's a very, very, you could arguably read Murakami Haruki's novels as a kind of reaction to that wet, violent, erotic culture, tight-knit, sticky culture of the 60s and 70s. It had to happen, and interesting things can come from that too. The fact that the other Murakami, Murakami Takashi, who began his artistic life as a Nihonga artist, And that he's the sort of, for a while, for a long time, was the cutting edge of avant-garde Japanese art in the late 20th and early 21st century. And he ended up doing designs for Louis Vuitton. That alone shows you how different the culture that came after the 70s has become. I was ambivalent about it myself, since I'm by nature more inclined to the dry than the wet. I found it fascinating what I saw in the 70s in Japan. Was not entirely sympathetic to it, but in retrospect, I'm becoming more and more sympathetic to it. I miss the sense of revolt, the physical danger, the edginess, the radicalism of the culture in Japan when I lived there. But I suppose one could say this not about Japan, but about culture in general in the world we're living in today, which has other excitements. So I'll end it with that, and you can ask me anything you like. Yes.
So, feel free to ask any questions. There's, Barbara has a mic, yeah. And there's one over here, too.
Thank you very much. Tokyo Romance was a love letter to Tokyo.
Yes.
And I very much appreciated it. But I felt like it focused on a particular aspect of Japanese art and protest.
Yes.
There's the Fluxus movement, which was also very political and was contemporaneous with the porno films. It was a different kind of expression, maybe the dry more than the wet. Yayoi Kusama. You also have the women's movement, which grows out of that that time. So there are different expressions as well. And the kind of personal freedom was very much a kind of a homoeroticism, mm-hmm. And about a freeing of masculinity, mm-hmm. more than one about feminism and a inscription of femininity. So I'd like you to talk more broadly,
yes.
about the sort of cultural milieu of the time.
Well, you're absolutely right. And none of the people I've mentioned, except possibly Oshima, would have survived the Me Too period for 5 minutes. That's certainly true. It was certainly very masculine. And Buto, perhaps more than anything. And of course, these different things were going on, and no culture, even an underground culture, is ever monolithic. All I can say to that is that I've described something I was drawn to. And so the book Tokyo Romance is, it is a memoir, and it is very much about the world that I was drawn to and saw. That other things were going on at the same time is certainly true. I think the feminist wave, although it existed, I think probably came a bit later. I don't think it was very much in evidence then at all. Yes.
Thank you very much for this very exciting insight into the culture of that time. You didn't mention anything about nature. You know, in the traditional Japanese art, you know, this relationship and connection with the nature of, and would that have any sort of influence on the theater and the art of the period you're describing?
Well, I think the kind of art and theater that I've described was mostly very urban. Certainly Terayama's theater, even though he did often sort of go back in his imagination to the rural northeast where he was born. But to the extent that nature played a role, it was that muddy aspect of nature. It was not the refined side of Japanese nature worship, if you want to call it that. It wasn't the cherry blossoms. Or the misty mountains. It was the muddy rice fields, the snow, the cold, the hardship. That played a role in Imamura's movies and so on, but not the I mean, you have to really see what I described, and I entirely agree with the former speaker. There were other things going on too. I mean, like Nihonga, which did have things that more to do with the kind of depictions of nature that you're suggesting. But the world that I'm describing was really a rebellion against all that. They didn't want the, if you look at the photographs of Moriyama and others, they didn't want prettiness and sort of mystical experiences of nature. They wanted ugliness. They wanted to show the brutality of modern urban life, the billboards, the sort of dirty little back streets, and so that's what interested them, and not the what people mostly associate with sort of Japanese refinement and love of nature.
Thank you, Professor, for your talk. And I personally also work on post-war Japan. I work on the novelist Oe Kenzaburo, particularly. And like from your talk, I was really fascinated by your notions of like how this subversiveness from the radical left-wing activity and how it was transferred to the world of porno. So that's also like my research question, like how do I digest this sort of relationship between the political and the erotic?
Right. Yeah. Well, the first thing to do is they're not very well translated, but you can get the essays by Oshima, which were published in English. Uh-huh. And he writes very well about that, because he started as a student sort of revolutionary in Kyoto University, right, and was very much part of the Umpo generation.
And the other thing about from your talk, you mentioned that this sort of political activity in the 60s and 70s like gave people flashbacks about the Meiji Restoration and how people go against it or like supported it or against the Bakufu government. But this sort of representation of the the narratives seems to me is like a circular kind of historiography. So that's also like part of my concern, like how do I understand this sort of flashbacks or parallels like from the past and also the 60s as the present moment.
Well, I'm not entirely sure I understand quite what you're getting at, but perhaps one can start with something that Natsume Soseki said famously, and I think in the 20s, maybe a little bit earlier, somebody might know. But he said somewhere, Japan was westernizing and absorbing Western culture so fast that one day soon it would start to suffer from a severe case of indigestion. And that really happened in the 30s, when there was this very nativist reaction against Western culture, and which was militant and militaristic and right-wing and so on. And the generation of the 60s, I think, also reacted against that sense of indigestion and all these layers of Westernized high culture, and rebel, and which were very much part of the sort of idea of Bume Kaika, and rebelled against that, but not in the same way that the nationalists of the 1930s, the sort of Kyotoha and so on, did. Does that answer your question?
Yeah.
Thank you.
I have a comment.
you already have the microphone, or?
Yeah.
Okay.
Thank
you. I'm an economist, and I study the Japanese economy. And when I think about 1974, I think about this being after 20 years of truly incredible economic growth and transformation of most people's material lives in Japan. And I wonder if you think that was reflected in some of these cultural issues you're discussing.
Yeah, except that, of course, there was the oil shock and all the rest of it. But Japan was still growing pretty fast in the 70s. And so I think a lot of the protest culture was against the effects of the that sort of great economic boom. The first year I lived in Japan, and that has something to do with the economic situation at the time. One of my first memories is watching people in front of the Shinjuku station throwing peanuts at pictures of Tanaka Kakue, because Tanaka had been the one who was brought down by the Lockheed scandal. And that was very much part of the Japanese world at the time, that Tanaka and his cronies had made deals to get kickbacks from Lockheed in exchange for, I think it was jet fighters, but I'm not quite sure. Jal buying aeroplanes. But they called the kickbacks in their communications peanuts. So we expect to get 300 peanuts next time we meet and so on. So that was part of the atmosphere. But Japan was both visibly still getting wealthier, and at the same time, there were a lot of rough edges still, which made it exciting, actually. I mean, I rather liked the rough edges, but that's, again, you know, a question of personal taste.
Well, thank you very much for your beautiful talk. And that helped me to understand the violence and eroticism of many Japanese movies, and that brought some associations with the 60s and 70s in Europe and in Latin America.
Absolutely.
I was living in Argentina then. And it came to my mind a very iconic figure, photograph, that is Yoko Ono and John Lennon, who, I don't know if it was true or not, but spent a marathonic period of time making love. And so how these two, you know, the Western and the East, the West and the East, get together, and eroticism is probably the only way, as you said, from an individual to subvert, no?
Yeah, that is my argument. Funnily enough, I mean, Yoko Ono was much more of a figure in the West than in Japan. I mean, nobody talked in the 70s about Yoko Ono. I mean, sometimes John Lennon maybe, but not Yoko Ono for some reason. I mean, she was not a figure in the on the Tokyo scene. I need to remind you, though, I'm sure you are aware of it, but when we talk about the violence in Japanese entertainment, we have to bear in mind that it's all very much in the imagination, because actually there was very little violence in Japanese society. So this could be an argument for those who say, you know, you shouldn't censor violence or pornography or anything like that, because it's not true that if people watch these things, they'll go out and do it. There is an argument to be made that if they watch it, they won't do it, because you can get rid of these impulses by simply imagining them as they're being acted out. Japanese society may be an example of that, because it was actually a very peaceful society with very little violent crime compared to, say, Argentina at the time, where there was real violence, state violence and revolutionary violence. And it reminds me of something that Jean Genet, the French writer, once said about the 1930s, and he was always fascinated by crime and violence and that kind of thing in his literature, and he was rather proud of having been a petty thief himself and having been in prison. And he said he used to be interested in Germany, but he had absolutely no interest in Nazi Germany anymore, because the violence was no longer subversive. It was the violence of the state itself. And don't know why I'm saying this, but in Japan, this was true, I think, in the 18th century too, and it was not a violent society. It was a very peaceful society, but the violence is all in the mind, which is where it should be, probably. Yes. Yeah, well, I that may be so in the case of Murakami, because he's a sort of an international figure. I mean, the people who played a role in the 70s were not. I mean, they were unknown outside Japan. They all wanted to, or not all, but many of them wanted to become well-known outside Japan, but they weren't. And so what they were not doing was pandering to Western taste. I do agree with you that probably Murakami Takashi, after all, he is Japanese and he understands the Japanese tradition very well, might have a similar penchant for the grotesque that is so much part of popular Japanese art going back centuries, going back to, you know, the earliest manga and that kind of thing. But I think, again, it's maybe the sign of a very regimented society where everybody knows their role and their position, and there's very little room for eccentricity, really, that it's precisely in that kind of society where the art and the world of the imagination can become very eccentric and very extreme as a way to almost to let off steam. And I think that explains partly why Ero and Gudo and has been such a part of popular Japanese culture for centuries.
Thank you very much. So I'd like to ask kind of a related question related to Josh's previous question, which is sort of materialization and culture. So it seems that you touched upon the difference between the culture in 70s and the generations after, and it seems to me that you know, the society those people grew up was totally different.
Yes.
You know, in the 60s, you know, only 20% of people went to college, and until the early 70s, Japan is still a poor society, even in rural area. I have a friend who worked at a plutonium refinement plant in Rokkasho village in Aomori, and he heard a story about like infant killings, kuchiberashi in 60s or early 70s even. Mm-hmm. Whereas, you know, in late 70s and 80s, Japan was more sort of fluent, much more fluent society. And so I'm wondering if you have any sort of comments on the relationship between those sort of material
yes.
level and culture.
But not only affluence. I think that the big difference is that the generation that came after had no experience of war, and the violence and the poverty of the early post-war period. They'd grown up entirely in sort of bourgeois peace, and that clearly has an influence on people, that they'd escaped in many ways from not just from war itself, but the shadow of war. And it also perhaps explains the sort of depoliticization of the generations that came after. It's not just that they're less aware or knowledgeable, it's also that there was less reason to rebel because they were comfortable, relatively speaking. And that's never a good thing for culture.
Hi. Well, that somewhat answered my question, what you just said, but when was the last time you were in Japan?
Last January,
okay. Gonna try and summarize this. I hope it, if there's a trouble with the summary, feel free. So we have a post-war period where artists are coming to terms or coming to grips with what a post-war Japanese world should be like. And he mentioned Oe
Kenzaburo.
Kazaburo. And he felt like there was a period of post-war writing which was attempting that, which kind of came to an end in the early 70s where you were just coming in.
Right.
And then what you said is that when that spirit of trying to guide or mold Japanese culture kind of comes to an end, then it shifts into the arts, where you get guys like Oshima trying to blend pornography and artistry. So my question is there a counterculture alive in Japan today? If it all kind of stopped politically and then went into the arts and then even the arts kind of faded from it, where is it today?
Right. Well, but you could ask the same question about the United States. I mean, is there a counterculture here? Not in the same way, no. Because Japan is no, as so often, Japan is no, the Japanese themselves like to think that everything there is unique and totally unlike anywhere else and so on. Of course, it isn't true. I mean, Japan is no different from other parts of the developed world, and everything is fragmented, and it's much of it's online, and everybody has their niches. And I mean, the idea of theater groups and filmmakers and so on working together in a kind of rebellious atmosphere, which where sometimes the police has to intervene and all that, it doesn't exist.
Is there anybody or any filmmaker who you would call or writer who you would consider
critical of Japan who's operating today?
Well, no doubt there are, but it's not part of a rebellious culture. Of course, there must be there. Of course, obviously.
But individuals rather than as a movement.
I would have thought. And the sort of young Japanese artistic in the visual arts. I mean the school of Murakami Takashi and so on. There is a bit of criticism, but it's not very radical. It's very soft.
So thank you so much for the talk. I look forward to talking more at dinner about some of the stories that that might not work as well here. So one of the things I was thinking about, and I think it's related to some of the questions that have already circulated, has to do with just thinking about like what the nature of subversion or rebellion might look like now. And it struck me as you were talking about writers like Murakami Haruki, you know, of whom I'm not a fan. I think partially because of some of the things you're talking about. You know, I'm more a fan of Oe or Tanizaki or Abe Kolbo. These kind of, I think, in your kind of schema, the kind of the wetter. As opposed to the more deliberately respectable or even kind of pandering kind of artists. And so I was wondering a little bit in terms of theater and performance, what that looks like now, because I was thinking too about like artists like Sankai Juku, and there's a difference. I saw them, I guess, 2 years ago when they came here, and one of the things that stood out was kind of being familiar with some of the older Butoh that you're talking about, and the impact of that was a kind of tameness and a certain kind of smoothing away of some of that muddy reek or something that you're kind of nostalgic for now, and trying to think about what the nature of that kind of aesthetic or artistic kind of protest looks like. It seems to me that the body is still really important and will still become kind of the basis for that kind of criticism. But I wonder a little bit about, you know, what the nature of that would be, or if there are certain kind of either artists or trends that you kind of recognize now that's not just kind of artists now looking back to say the 60s and trying to kind of rekindle that necessarily, but trying to kind of move in different directions, if you have a sense of that.
Yeah, I must confess, I haven't really kept up with the theatrical scene enough to say anything very insightful about that. I do think there's been a general smoothing in all the arts and in politics and so on. The atmosphere of Tokyo today, if you compare it to the 70s, I mean, it's again, I mean, there are so many parallels to other cities, London or is a good example. A lot of the sort of edge and the edginess of subversive and protest culture has made way for far more interest in lifestyle, much better restaurants, a lot of foodieism. There wasn't really any foodieism in the 70s in Japan, and now it's the foodie capital of the world. And so what you don't, I think, have in America, a lot of the energy now goes into gender and identity and representation and that kind of thing. I don't think that that's a huge issue in Japan. I may be wrong, but I don't sense that. So I'm not absolutely sure. I do want to say one other thing, though, because Oe was brought up. Oe sort of fits into the things I was talking about and not. He was rather dry, if anything, but although he was admired by people like Kara. But Oe is an interesting case because he was very influenced by France, as was Kara, actually. And part of the ambivalence about America, almost immediately after the war, led to a Japanese intellectual fascination with Europe, but especially France, which was partly for snobbish reasons and resentment. You know, these people with their aviator glasses and their bomber jackets and their big boots who were chew gum and so on, lording it over us, and, you know, why should we respect that, whereas in Paris you have these wonderful existentialists with their Gauloises, and so more and more Japanese intellectuals started to wear berets and smoke Gauloises and read Sartre, and including Kara, and Hijikata too, with his fascination for Hans Bellmer and de Sade and all that. There was a real francophilia, which was also part of the times. Probably, again, a bit less now than it was then. But that was part of the rebellion against America, was this turning towards France. And with Oe, I mean, even his Japanese prose style was consciously based on a kind of French influence. Would you agree?
I would agree. He often used allusion to 18th, 19th century French literature, and as well as like his representation of that. So, and he also graduated from the French literature department.
Yes, in Waseda. University. That's right.
So
when he graduated Tokyo University?
No, I think it was it Tokyo University? I always thought it was Waseda.
He's like elite.
No, I know. Yeah, sure.
So at this point, we'll take one more question if it exists. Otherwise, we can end here and thank our speaker. Are there any other questions? No? Great. Well, then join me in thanking our speaker, Professor Ian Bruma. Thank you so much.